Tonight we are presenting the new Hewlett-Packard 150, which is a significant milestone in the world of populist personal computers, really for two reasons. It's Hewlett-Packard's really first major entry into this mass market, and there are two significant things about it. First is that there's been a great deal of hullabaloo in the last year or so about computers with mouse pointing devices, which many people consider the avant-garde thing right now. And it's really kind of important that Hewlett-Packard has chosen not to go with that technology. They've made a commitment to touch-sensitive technology. And that may have some very interesting implications in the future as to which technology is really going to be the predominant one in making, as the popular buzzword now, consistent user interfaces, ways to interact consistently with the different application programs the computer has. The other thing is that Hewlett-Packard has chosen to go with 3.5-inch disks, which is another possibly very important trend that could be pushed along with this new product. So it's very interesting, and we hope you have a chance to come afterward and have a look at it. It's definitely something different, and we're happy to show it to you here tonight. We have Bob Puett, who is manager of the Personal Office Products Division of Hewlett-Packard in from California, who will be presenting the HP 150.
Okay, thank you. It's a real pleasure to be here tonight, particularly tonight, because I understand we had quite an exciting day on Wall Street as HP's trading was suspended, starting off with quite an imbalance in orders. And it was basically due to the fact that we announced our fourth quarter and year-end results in October. We finished the year at $4.9 billion in sales, which was up 18% over 1982. Shipments were $4.7 billion, up 12%. And one of the nice parts is net profit was up 13% over last year, growing faster than shipments in 1983, which has been a kind of a challenging market for a lot of us in the computer and related businesses. Perhaps most exciting was our fourth quarter results. Orders were up 32% over the previous year. Fourth quarter shipments were a record $1.33 billion, the largest ever for HP. And a net profit for our company exceeded 10% net for the entire fourth quarter. Again, I think quite an achievement in the industry today. We continue with a cash position in excess of $700 million at this point in time. And I guess from my personal standpoint, one of the neatest parts of that whole thing was since I have been intimately associated with the HP 150 for the last several years, we shipped several thousand HP 150s during the month of October to really contribute to that. I thought before I got started tonight, I might just briefly introduce myself. After leaving graduate engineering school at Stanford, I joined HP 17 years ago. At that time, the company was less than $200 million, and that is actually less than the size of the division that I am managing today. I've been involved in all sorts of our parts of our computer business, from developing internal systems, data communication systems, business systems. Been involved in selling and manufacturing our business systems and technical systems. Before my current job, was responsible for our worldwide service and support organization for all of our computer products. Last 3 years have been very exciting. I've been involved in the personal computer business at HP, and as Jonathan said, currently manage our personal office computer division, which is responsible for all of HP's desktop personal computers. Really had two major objectives tonight. The first one was I thought I might share with you for a few minutes a little insight into how the touchscreen PC actually came about within HP. As I go through that, this little scenario that took place over the last couple years, I think you might get some interesting views into HP and how things can happen in our company. And a second thing I'd like to do is to give you an update on just what the HP 150 touchscreen computer is all about. Let me start off with a little bit of history. We spent a great deal of time actually during the 1981 time frame, June through October, really formulating our strategy for the personal computer business. Very key time for us, to say the least. Right in the middle of that, we introduced, in fact, on August 2nd, 1981, our first general purpose PC. I really say that as it was kind of a dubious pleasure, because that was the day before IBM announced their PC. Ours was the HP 125. It was an 8-bit Z80 based CPU. It really grew out of our terminal product line. It was a fair product for HP, but I would not say a resounding success. What it did provide for us was an excellent product to learn a great deal on, to learn about the marketplace, and to begin to get into the business. By November of 1981, we'd really formulated the strategy for the product we called the 150. Now, we didn't know we were going to call it that when we were developing it and defining it, but we had it defined at that point in time. We'd made a very clear decision to go with the Intel processor family at that point in time. We decided to use industry standard operating systems at that point in time and really augment those two things with HP quality and additional features that would make the product that we came out with a real contribution in the marketplace. I would say that in November of 81, the product was 75% defined exactly the way we introduced it 23 months later in October of this year. January of 82, we went through some organizational changes, and that happens in a big company. As I'm sure you're probably aware of, we at that point in time combined our one personal computer division and a terminal division and combined all the research and development labs between those two groups. That was an interesting time for me in trying to sort out the things that really made sense to continue to do, to follow on with, what things to cancel and how to reorient the program. What came out of that was the fact that in our terminal lab, we had been doing extensive research into touchscreen capability, as we saw that really could make a contribution for terminal-based products. We had not been doing that in the PC area. That looked very interesting to us and was one that we decided at that point in time in January to really, really pursue. But we decided to pursue it very interestingly as an option on the product. We thought it would be an interesting option to have for the marketplace. In December of 82, and basically it was the day before Christmas last year, I remember it very well, we made a major change in the operating system that we were going to use on the product. It was pretty clear throughout last year that the MS-DOS operating system had become a very strong standard in the business, and that was the one that we decided to switch to in the Christmas time frame, and that was a big effort for us to switch a lot of software development to make sure that that all came about when we introduced the product. In the January to May time frame of this year, we simplified the product definition a great deal, and we actually spent a great deal of time in market research and in focus groups really trying to understand the product that we had. The product that we had a great deal of options and a lot of choices on how to go about configuring the product. And as I mentioned before, touch was still an option. In that time frame, we decided to do two things. One of them came from the focus groups, and they really said, this touch is fantastic. Anybody that tried it, everybody that looked at it, came up with the conclusion this was the really dynamite feature in the product. We made a decision to make it standard. We not only made a decision to make it standard, but we mounted a very large effort to make sure that all of the software that we were developing and a great deal of software packages that we were working with the vendors on would make extensive use of touch. And that is really key. Having touch is one thing, really making use of it is something else. And I think when you all get a chance to see the product later, and I'll try to give you a little demo as I go through my talk tonight, you'll see that touch really makes a big difference. The other thing we did was we simplified the product to the point that there are no options on the product. We decided to include all the key features in the product and make it really a simple product to order and have really a very high performance machine. I guess the last thing that happened that made a significant change in the product occurred in April of this year. We'd been working for about 2 years on trying to define a common keyboard layout that we would use on all of our terminals, all of our personal computers, all of our workstations within the company. Well, it was in the March-April timeframe of this year where we'd actually got about 10 different divisions to finally agree on what that keyboard layout was going to look like. And in fact, we had a very detailed plan formulated to implement that on a product that we had introduced in about mid-1984. Well, the fellows came out of the lab one night. Friday night's kind of an interesting night around our shop. We wind up comparing notes and in a very informal way, and they brought out a couple prototypes of what this keyboard was going to look like. And we put in front of the HP 150 and took the other keyboard that we'd used in our terminal products away. And I think we all just looked at each other simultaneously and said, that is the keyboard that we have got to have on this product. That turned out to be the last Friday in April. All of the mechanical design team, electrical design team for the product was standing around. We all looked at each other and said, yeah, let's go for it. We're going to do it. And that was probably one of the fastest developments we've ever had in the company. In less than 4 months, we ramped to a many thousand per month rate. We did tooling that normally takes 8 and 9 months in 2 months. We signed contracts with switch vendors, did the electronics, in fact, did the PC board with all the electronics that's actually in the keyboard. We turned around from a schematic concept to working PC boards in less than 7 days, which I think set a new record. And I guess the exciting thing to me is while we're a large company, we can still do things very fast, and that demonstrated it to me in the process. Okay, with that as kind of a background on how we got to where we are today, I'd like to take the opportunity to take a look at the HP 150, and I don't know how I go about turning on the slide projector, but I guess I say I'd like to have the slide projector, and it comes on. Okay. Okay, we call the product the touchscreen personal computer, and I think that really is appropriate for the product. It really is the differentiator in the marketplace. The product is a very complete system, complete computer, printers, plotters, peripherals, and software form the entire HP 150 system that we have today. And I will go through in more detail some of the peripherals and other components of the product that we think it makes it pretty significant. The CPU is an 8088. However, we're running that product at 8 megahertz, which is roughly twice the speed of what's in the IBM PC and most others today. And I'll show you some performance numbers in a minute to give you a feel for what that does for us. Memory is expandable very easily. We built in 256 KB to start off with. We felt that was really going to be the pretty much standard minimum configuration that was needed in the marketplace, and it looks like it is today. The product's expandable to 640 KB, and that can be done by plugging in an optional memory card. Probably one of the unique features of the product today is the fact that it's a built-in 2623 terminal. Now, what's that really mean? The 2623 is really an HP terminal. It's our defined standard for a block mode full graphics terminal within our company. Without disks, the product is a full block mode graphics terminal and does an exceptional job of that by itself. In addition to being a HP graphics terminal, part of the firmware that's in the base product supports the complete Tech 4012, 4014 graphics compatibility mode as well. We have built-in data communications with two RS-232 ports coming standard with the product, as well as the HPIB. Of course, that's the name that we use to refer to the IEEE 488 standard interface bus, which we use in the product. Two accessory slots are available to use for memory or data communications capability or some other options that we see coming out over the next year. And again, a unique feature, the friendly user interface, I think is really combined of two things: our personal applications manager, which I'm going to give you an update on and really show you how it works in just a minute, as well as the touch capability that really make the product quite unique today. This is the keyboard that I talked about before, which we think is quite a contribution. It will be the standard on all future PCs and terminals coming out of Hewlett-Packard, which we think is going to have a huge impact in the software development that we do internally in the company as well as with our ISVs. Some key features of the product, we have 8 screen-labeled soft keys, and they're highlighted as the darker keys on the main part of the keyboard. But we also made sure to add 4 more in the process, so we have 12 soft keys, making it very easy to port software. Been written four machines either using 8, 10, or 12 keys. Sculpted keycaps, dished home keys, special word processing editing keys are built in, an integral numeric keypad, and you might notice if you can see, which you can take a look at later, right above the numeric keypad, we've integrated the complete set of arithmetic functions, which I personally find very handy in using for such things as VisiCalc and other numeric applications. This is the thing we're going to talk about later. Touching the screen is really the magic in the product. I'm going to talk about it quite a few times during my talk tonight, but I'm always going to have to say you got to touch it to believe it, because it really makes a big difference in how it works. Here's some performance numbers that I mentioned. These are based on some fairly common standards or benchmarks that are run in the industry today. I guess one of the things that it doesn't really show is the fact that we have 160 KB of firmware built into the product. This is the firmware that gives us the terminal capability that's standard in the HP 150 today. It also consists of a great deal of input-output system commands. We call them the alpha and graphics, AGIOS commands, which allow us to do very fast screen handling. And in fact, when you take a look at the product later, I'd really like you to notice the fact that we can really paint that screen almost instantly in front of your eyes. That also gives us the capability to do a smooth scroll, so you can really read as you scroll through memory and scroll through what you have on your display. It's very easy to read what's on the screen. Graphics capability is also very strong. The product has a 512 by 390 graphics resolution. The alpha resolution is actually even higher than that, giving us a very good position in the marketplace in that regard today, and I think you'll see when you take a look at the graphics capabilities that we have that they in fact are really strong. From a data communication standpoint, I guess I'd like to split this slide into two parts. The top half are products that we have available and are shipping now, and we have a package called Link 150. This allows us to communicate very effectively between two HP 150 products. Complete error detection and correction is built into that. File transfer capability is built into that. It's a very simple conversational mode. That same product works with our HP 3000, which is our really ubiquitous multi-user system, making it a very simple matter to log on to a 3000 and work with the 3000 product. We have announced, as far as communication with the IBM mainframe, the fact that we will be supplying in the first part of 84 a plug-in card supporting the 3278 terminal emulation mode for connecting directly to an IBM mainframe. So you directly come out of the back of your 150 with coax into a 3274 or other appropriate device. The lower right-hand corner, HP 150 to the IBM PC, is a product that we're working on now and will also be available in the first part of 84. And that's basically taking this Link package that I was talking about before and supplying that for the IBM PC. So it's just as easy to communicate back and forth between the IBM PC and the HP 150 as between two 150s. As mentioned before, the operating system that we chose was MS-DOS. We see that as really the dominant standard in the industry today. We're running the 2.0 version of that product. We chose it clearly because of the wide range of software that we could easily migrate to our product. We have enhanced MS-DOS, particularly for HP Touch, which is built in, and added our personal application manager, the thing we affectionately call PAM, and I'll show you that as part of a demo that I'm going to try to do here on the screen for you in just a few minutes. I get a lot of questions on, gee, is your MS-DOS the same as MS-DOS on whatever in the process? And I'd like to attempt to answer that with this slide here. The core MS-DOS is exactly the same. No, we haven't got in, we haven't modified that part of the product. We have had to extend it, like other vendors in the process, to include the capabilities that I just mentioned, like the interface to HP Touch, to take advantage of the AGIOS firmware commands for fast screen handling that I talked about before. We've added several utilities to it as well, but the core product is in fact basically the same, making it easy to move software from either MS-DOS or similar machines. We have a complete line of peripherals for the product, and maybe one of the most unique ones I'd like to talk about. We have a separate division within our company dedicated to making personal computer printer products alone. This is one of their first products. It is unique, I think, to the HP 150 today. It is a user installable, drop-in, 120 character a second thermal printer. This product weighs just a little over a pound, I believe, can be installed in less than a minute, and I guess I've got to the point now where I can pretty regularly do it in front of an audience in about 30 seconds. It has one cable to connect, which is part of the base product. When you buy it from HP, that cable provides all signals and all power. There's two clips that hold the printer in place. The cover actually comes with the base product. It really makes it simple to install and use. The product sells for $495 and allows virtually at any point in time at the touch of your finger to print a copy of what's on the screen, which I think you would all agree is a very handy indeed feature to have. And I encourage all of you to take an opportunity to do that right after we finish the talk here. In addition to the drop-in thermal printer, we have several other printers available for the product. 80 character per second thermal printers plus dot matrix printers, two letter quality printers that we offer, and two plotters. These are the two plotters that I think HP has pretty much made famous in the business today, our two-pin, two-color plotter, and the new six-pin plotter that is really, I think, an outstanding contribution. And the software, of course, that we've developed takes a lot of advantage of these two peripherals. We offer three disk drives with the product, which you can have your choice of. They are all in the same footprint that we have for the base product, which is roughly 12 inches on a side. The three disks are the dual 3.5-inch micro floppy on the bottom, and the package, which is slightly taller, it's about 1 inch taller, as a matter of fact, but the same footprint. We offer a choice of a 3.5-inch micro floppy with either a 5 megabyte or a 15 megabyte Winchester drive. Both those products are available and shipping in quantity right now. Now what I'd like to do is to take a look at the HP 150 in action. And this is something that is really difficult to do, but I'm going to try to give you a feel for what it's like to use a touchscreen computer and try to do it on a slideshow in the process. I guess I might encourage you to everybody get their get your index fingers ready, because when I say touch the screen, just imagine that you're going to touch the screen in the process. This will be the last piece of digital equipment that you'll need to run our product, by the way. Okay, let's start off and take a look at how we might do a word processing application and how we could use touch in the process. Let's say that you just wrote a memo, you just had typed that out, you printed it out, and you decided now that you want to interchange the first and the second paragraph in the process. Let's see how we go about doing that. Well, we turn on our system, and one of the unique things about the product is when you turn on the HP 150, it does not require a three-finger exotic commands. It does not require, in fact, you to touch the keyboard at all. It comes up in our personal application manager that we call PAM, and this is exactly what the screen looks like when it comes up. Now, in the process of turning on, of course, it's running diagnostics on the CPU, disks, printers, and everything that's built into it. It also scans all of the disk drives that you have attached to the system, and on the HPIB bus, you can attach up to 7 disk drives, so you can have a rather large amount of storage. It scans all of those to see what software packages that you have installed, and then displays those on the screen here. And in fact, each one of those areas, those lighted areas, 5 across and 4 down, are individual software packages. So there's 20 packages available at the touch of your finger. And you can, in fact, scroll through memory and display that on the screen, so you can have a much larger number than that instantly available at your fingertip to start with. Well, we were going to start with our memo and modify that. So I guess what we'd want to do is to call up our word processing package, and here we have WordStar. Touch the screen and you're loading WordStar into the system. Now we need, of course, to type in the name of our file, which we've stored our memo on, and we bring the memo or letter up for us to edit. Now, what's it take to go about changing those paragraphs? What we would do would be to touch one of the soft keys. And the soft keys are really shown. Those are the eight keys or eight lighted areas across the bottom of the screen. They correspond to eight keys on our keyboard. If you'd like to push the keyboard and keep your hands down there, or if you'd like to touch them, they're on the screen. So they work either way. You'd push the or touch the soft key that says you'd like to mark a block of data. With your finger, then you'd touch the upper left-hand corner of that block, the lower right-hand corner of that block. As soon as you touch the lower right-hand corner and pull your finger away, that block of data or block of text is highlighted and be on a screen just exactly like I've shown it right here. Then you can scroll through your text, decide where you'd like to put it. Really, it's a matter of simply touching the screen to show where you want to put it. Again, touch a soft key to say insert, and bang, you've done it. So in fact, by touching the screen about four or five times, you can move a block of text anywhere that you'd like. We think that's a lot easier than doing it using cursors and other methods in the marketplace today. Okay, let's go back and take a look at another application. This one's graphics. By the way, we can go back to PAM, the Personal Application Manager, at any point in time from any application. We've reserved one of the soft keys on the screen at all times to exit the program that you're in and go back to PAM. So you hit that, you're back into PAM. And let's decide we wanted to make a pie chart in this case. And so we load in our pie chart graphics package, and here's what comes up. This is a complete formatted screen ready for you to edit and put together the graph that you would like in the process. Note, I'm not sure if you can read it or not, but on the left-hand column, we have, it says pen at the top, and then you have eight choices. You can pick for any particular segment of your pie chart the pen number that you'd like, and of course that corresponds to some color that you've already established. In a second column are the various shading types that you have, so you can pick what shading type that you'd like. In order to get the pen color and the shading type to match a particular segment in the pie chart, you just touch the pie chart, touch that segment, and that will change immediately in the process. Let's say we'd like to explode a particular segment. There's a soft key at the lower part of the screen that says to expand or explode a segment. You touch that, you point to the segment. As soon as you touch the segment, automatically it is exploded in the process. And in fact, let's say you wanted to change the shading on that. Again, right on the screen, you simply touch the shading box that you would like to change it to, in this case solid, and we have and then touch the segment, and you've changed the shading. So you can literally edit that pie chart in a matter of seconds, and all you wind up doing is just touching it, and you keep touching it until you get what you'd like. And then, of course, as soon as you get it the way you'd like it, you can just print it out on the internal printer to get a preview copy long before you plot it. Let's take a look at a third application, and this one is spreadsheet analysis. One of the big things that makes spreadsheet analysis so popular on these machines today is just the ability to be able to do what-if type analyses. And what-if usually means, what if I change this number? And instead of pointing to it with a pencil, of course, with the touchscreen computer, we load in VisiCalc, and then we can simply use our finger, or in fact, you can use a pencil, or virtually any pointing device, let's say about a quarter of an inch in diameter or more. You can use that to point to that individual element that you'd like to modify. Go to your keyboard, put in the new data or value that you'd like to put in for that element. Either touch the screen at one of the soft keys that says calculate my spreadsheet, or touch a key on the keyboard and do the same thing. So it becomes really easy to do the what-if type analyses. The last product that I'd like to talk about, and really try to give you a feel for where touch, I think, is exciting today, is a product that we call Personal Card File. This is a software package that we developed. I frankly think that it will have the same impact on the Rolodex and other filing systems that you find on many people's desks today that VisiCalc has had on big green sheets of spreadsheet paper in the process. Let's take our finger, let's touch PCF and load it in. And lo and behold, it looks exactly like a Rolodex. And in fact, that's exactly what we did. We implemented a Rolodex right down to the exact shape that one is that you would buy in the store today. We implemented that on the screen. Imagine yourself touching the wheels, either on the left or the right. Normally, you'd use the knob and roll it. You touch it with your finger, and you can roll it backwards or forwards, left-handed or right-handed in the process, fast or slow. And with the smooth scroll capability that is part of the system, it's very easy to read all of those tabs and all those cards as you go through your Rolodex. Of course, if you'd like to take a look at any one of those cards, you simply touch it, and up comes the card format. Kind of interesting, the software team that was writing this, we had suggested to them they could speed up the process a little bit if they just used a square format, but they were really dedicated to making it a real Rolodex, and you can see the card format is just exactly like you'd get in a Rolodex. You can format these cards very rapidly, very similar if you're familiar with the Condor database package that's in the industry today. It takes maybe 3 or 4 minutes to formulate and define the fields on a card. Very easy to set them up. And this is, I think, maybe one of the most exciting parts of the product that we build into it. If you have used a phone number, and this is virtually any type of phone number, a phone number that you would call up the source with, or a phone number of a friend or a long-distance call or a customer or whatever. If you've used a phone number as any field in that card layout, you can touch that soft key down in the lower left-hand corner, and it says dial phone. Built into the package, if you have a modem attached to the product, is that capability today. So you can imagine having maybe your customer base, your client base or whatever in the process. You scan through your Rolodex, find the card you want, and dial the phone in the process. We think that's going to be kind of exciting with the kind of capabilities that'll offer. We've talked about how touch is used in everything from spreadsheet analysis to word processing here. And in fact, we have a lot more software packages available. This shows the software packages that we are shipping today. We have about 20 packages that were available at introduction time and shipping at introduction time in the first part of October. I talked before about the decision that we made in the early part of 83 to add touch as a standard part of the product and really make sure that we use touch in these software packages. And to give you a feel there, those are all the packages that have extensively incorporated the touch capability today. We have a lot more products, software products that we're working on. Some of these have been announced, some will continue to be announced. We'll be adding all of the following packages to that list and shipping these during the months of December and January. Every one that I've shown there, if it's been developed by an independent software vendor, we have contracts with those people at this point in time, and we're at least in an alpha testing mode, or it wouldn't be on the slide. One of the highlights of the product, and I'd like to finish with this, is the fact that we really focused on the footprint of the product because we think for a professional, you'd like to have a PC in your desk in addition to something else and not take the whole desk for it. The HP 150 has one of the smallest footprints in the industry today, and here just on a rough basis, we've shown the comparison versus some of the other products in the marketplace. I might point out these numbers include the keyboard, and in fact, the keyboard footprint on the 150 is bigger than the CPU. This first slide shows the product just in square inches in comparison to an Apple product. We might add a Deck Rainbow to that and take what that looks like and an IBM PC. The total footprint, including the keyboard of the 150, is about half of what the IBM PC is today. And in fact, I think you'll find fits very comfortably on your desk since in that for the CPU alone, about 12 inches on a side gives you your disks, CPU, and a built-in printer capability. The 150 sold in four configurations today. I mentioned that the product comes standard as a terminal, and we are selling it as a terminal to a lot of our customers. And then you can add in either one of the three disk drives that I talked about before. The most highly capable system we have, the 15 megabyte combined with a 3.5 inch micro floppy HP 150, sells for $6,450. And I'd like to point out those numbers don't include the printer. The printer's $495 and is user installable and drops in, as I mentioned, quite easily. I'd like to briefly finish by acknowledging all these trademarks and copyrights to make sure that I don't insult anybody in the process. Our legal team made sure that I had that built into the program. We think HP Touch is really unique. Whether it'll set you free or not, I don't know. I think you have to try it. Touching is believing. It's a real magic capability that we think is going to be play a big part in the marketplace today. If I could get the lights back on, I'd like to thank everybody for going through a brief demonstration of the HP 150 there. Thank you for your attention, and I'd be glad to, at this point in time, to take any questions that anybody might have in the audience. Yes, sir.
Do you have any expectations about how many units you'll ship in 84? For planning purposes and for
we don't have any specific numbers at this point in time that I'd like to divulge. I guess the most specific number would be to say that we ship several thousand units in the month of October. Our plans are to more than double that in November. How many we ship in 84 is going to depend a lot on how strong our orders are. We don't have any announced objectives for that.
Just with respect to the software you have available now, one of the problems I think many people have with selecting a system is that they're concerned that third-party software writers will not embrace a given system unless there's a real robustness in the anticipated market. Would you comment on that for purposes of encouraging third-party software people to respond to this product?
Well, I guess we were very pleased in the March time frame. We went out to the top, at least what we believe to be the top 40 ISVs in the business today, and asked them, we showed them the product, talked about its capabilities, asked them for their response, and they wouldn't give us back any systems in the process. They all kept at least a couple, and I believe every one of those 40 independent software vendors will have products available for the HP 150. I don't know how else to answer that. I guess one thing I should point out, they asked me before, if anybody's going to ask a question, if you'd stand up so you can get on videotape and be famous here, that would be appreciated. Any other questions? Yes, down in the front.
Do you have any plans to provide any degree of integration between your packages, such as putting the pie chart within the memo?
Plans to provide the integration. One of the things that we have done, and that's part of PAM, is to provide a capability and a common file format to make it very easy to take data, for example, out of a spreadsheet and move it over to the graphics package. That has been incorporated in there right now. It's also similarly easy to take VisiCalc spreadsheets or graphics capabilities and quite easily embed them in a document. We see further integrating those products, but at this point in time, that's the degree of integration that we have done. It's very easy to move data back and forth between the packages. Yes, sir.
Why did you decide to use the small disk, and do you have plans to offer a disk drive for the 5.25 inch?
Question was, why did we decide to use the 3.5 inch disk? I guess that really comes back to about 2 years ago when we really made an extensive study of all the disk floppy disk products, in particular on the marketplace. Both the micros and the 5.25 inch drives. Our conclusion at that point in time was that the 3.5 inch drive would yield the greatest quality and performance in the business, particularly because of the packaging that had been designed for that floppy disk. At that point in time, we made a corporate decision to support strictly the micro floppy, the 3.5 inch micro floppy, and that is our stance today. We have been a major force in establishing that as an industry standard. I understand at this point in time, one of the ANSI committees has picked the 3.5-inch microfloppy as the microfloppy standard. We expect it to be a standard in the industry, and we plan on continuing with that. No, at this point in time, we don't plan on offering 5.25-inch drives. We might offer some 3.5-inch drives for IBM. Yes, down in front.
If you get an Apple, you can get some pretty detailed information on how it works. Are you going to open this up and provide detailed reference and documentation to the user on this?
The answer is yes. First of all, the question was, are we going to really open it up, provide some detailed documentation on the product? The answer is yes, and it's yes in two ways. We are in the process of preparing a text. It's a large notebook of information for the independent software developer, independent software vendor. We've given preliminary copies, obviously, to all the ISVs that are out there today. In the first few months of 84, we'll make that available as a general reference document that you can buy. In addition, we are going to be supporting a similar program for independent hardware vendors and opening the product up to develop various hardware components, plug-in boards, et cetera, for it. So yes, software, and yes, hardware. Yes, for the user, right. Yes.
Speaking of the independent hardware folks, are you familiar with Carroll Technology, a company out in Illinois?
No.
The light emitting diodes.
Oh, Carroll Technology?
Yeah.
Yes, I'm very familiar with them. I know Carroll.
Yeah. Did you folks design and do this touch yourself, or did you license the Carroll Technology? Or touch is not an old or a new phenomena. It's been around with capacitance and light emitting diodes and so forth. I've been working with this stuff for about 5 years now on the capacitance format. This is not capacitance.
No.
This is similar to Carroll.
That's similar to Carroll.
Is this Carroll's technology
No.
or your technology?
No, it's not. It's we looked at all the various technologies for touch. We decided that the infrared diode matrix scheme was the most reliable and would give us the best performance for what we wanted to do with it. And we designed that from scratch. That's entirely an HP development.
Say I buy it, and 5 years from now, something goes wacko in the little diode, and when I touch something, it doesn't work.
How do we support the HP touch? Well, it turns out that in the bezel, and that's the medium gray colored bezel that surrounds the CRT, there's a relatively simple printed circuit board that has, it's a square board, it has all of the diodes as part of that board. That's a replacement throwaway PC assembly in our support organization. Part of our support strategy on any product we come out with in Hewlett-Packard is from the date of last manufacture, we provide complete customer support for 5 years after that date. So 5 years from now, no problem, and 5 years from many years from now when we decide to obsolete that product, still no problem. That'll be a stocked item around the world that you can literally pop in. Since we designed it to be an option, it was designed to be virtually user installable, so it literally pops in. There's one little connector and bang, in goes your touch. It's a very easy to support thing. It's probably the most reliable part of the product. It's a really clean design. Yes, sir.
If I were buying this for an office, not having had any experience with the relatively small screen, which I understand was probably developed to preserve the small footprint, I would be concerned, unless I had a chance to work at it day in and day out for several weeks, about whether there was any difficulty with a long-term basis in working with a small screen. Say a secretary was doing a lot of word processing on it,
right?
In addition to whatever other professional uses you might use it for in an office. Have you seen any problem with this? I don't really expect you to say yes. do you have any intention of coming out with a touch screen in any environment?
The question there really had to do with the size of the screen. Yes, we did focus on the 9-inch screen because of the footprint. We wanted to make sure that was small. Our real focus from a customer standpoint was on the professional, the moderate user, and not what I'd consider to be the dedicated word processing user, although what we've found so far is in a two-month time frame, if you can consider that much data, that has been very popular with a lot of the secretaries that are using them within HP. It would be reasonable to expect that we would come out in the next year or so with a 12-inch compatible product, perhaps more dedicated to dedicated applications like word processing. Frankly, one of the concerns that we did have in our focus group research was just that, the size of the screen. In fact, we were quite worried about it as we went out in the January, February, March timeframe. What came back after people used it, and I think after you wind up using the product, the resolution is so crisp in the process, and if in fact you're really using it and you're only an arm's length away because you're touching it in the process, the screen size does not turn out to be a problem. Our market research showed it to be a really very low on the list of things that if you were going to change, you'd want to change it. Yes, sir.
Are there outputs on the back for driving other monitors? Is this RGB or a monochrome output?
At this point in time, we don't have outputs on the back for driving other monitors. Something we're looking at, but we don't have today. Yes, sir, in a blue shirt.
Two questions. You talked about basically including all the options that were at one time considered to be available separately in the main package, and yet you didn't mention any 8087 option either on the main board or as a plug-in option. And secondarily, none of the packages you mentioned indicated programming languages. What languages does HP intend to support?
Okay, the first question had to do with 8087 support. That's true. We did not design the product with the 8087 processor in mind. I could go into a lot of reasons for that. Probably, I think the key one was how do we make it easily user installable in the process. We weren't sure how to go about doing that. And the second one is we looked at some of the future Intel processor families and in conjunction with them learned about their developments and development time frames for parallel products. We were unsure that we could continue to increase performance and continue to have that kind of capability always available. So we decided not to put an 8087 coprocessor in there. In regard to programming languages, we have BASIC today. It's Microsoft BASIC as a standard language. It's available. And the 1st of January, we'll be announcing 4 or 5, and I'm not sure which is the correct number, other languages, basically the complete Microsoft set of languages, compiled BASIC, Fortran, Pascal, will all be there in the January timeframe. C as well, I believe, is in that list. Yes, sir, one more question.
Yeah, do you expect to be bringing the system out in a portable package, and if so, in what time frame?
Do we expect to bring the product out in a portable package? I guess the best way to answer that is I think one of the greatest strengths that HP brings to bear in the marketplace today is we have a very powerful position, I think, in handheld calculators, portable computers today. Our strategy, very simply said, in the PC business is compatibility. And if I explain our strategy to customers, I say it's compatibility, compatibility, and compatibility. If we were to bring out a portable computer, it would be completely compatible with the HP 150. And I guess with our position in handhelds and portables today, that would be a reasonable assumption that sometime we might do that. One last question here.
What software is shipped with the product?
What software is shipped as part of the product today?
Yes.
We have not bundled in any application packages. What comes with the base product today is the operating system, the personal applications manager, a rather extensive demo program that virtually will let you, I think, learn how to use a great number of packages without having to read the manual or even buy the packages. The demo program runs at all the dealers, and I can say from my own standpoint, we have one of these in the lobby at the division where I'm at today. We put it in the lobby the day we introduced the product, and I've never seen it unattended. When I go out there late at night, the guards are playing with it, or somebody in a production line, or somebody's wife or husband has come in. You can learn how to use the product with the demo package. We've also included two tutors on how to use the HP 150, and they're self-paced, go through, touch the screen, learn how to use it. HP 150 tutors. That's what comes with the system. Okay, I'd like to thank everybody for your attention again, and I'd like to encourage you to come up and take a look at the HP 150s and touch them. Thank you.
Thank you, Bob. Unfortunately, we won't have a general BCS meeting in December. We hit quite a number of scheduling snafus with the holidays and all. But watch for something very exciting in January, very top secret, not totally confirmed yet, but all coming together very nicely, which you won't want to miss. The people from Hewlett-Packard will be here for a while up front and on the stage demonstrating the new HP 150. Thanks for coming, and we'll see you next in January.
John Stern.
Right, John.
Do you want to move to the left?
Sure.
Text is small, and I don't know if this is standard.
The light beams come down every other column in every row, so your finger is actually overlapping on two.
Yeah.
So in word processing, you're actually probably in between two letters, and that's when you'd use your cursor to hop over to the right exact letter that you want. Using a pencil is more accurate, but in an application such as VisiCalc, where your default and the cell is 7, you write into any cell that you want.
Yeah.
It's very accurate to one or two characters in the word processing mode.
Notice that D-Base was not mentioned as being D-Base. A touch.
No, not on touch.
No, sir.
I don't believe it will be. There's some applications that it really doesn't make too much sense to make touch. That is really keyboard dependent,
yeah.
D-Base too.
Yeah. Well, envisage it being touch. Touching a choice, mm-hmm. You know, from a D-Base generated menu or something. I mean, you have Condor on touch.
Yes, portions of Condor out.
Yeah.
What is the price for this?
Outside of the printer, $39.95. The printer is an additional $495.
What's the resolution of the printer?
Resolution of the printer is pretty much the same as that of the screen. It dumps it out dot for dot.
Mm-hmm.
Here's something that he was talking about before. If we wanted to change the text of one of those, for example, in Division A, we didn't like the hatch. Let's just make it blank. Do that. And out it comes. If we want to make it solid, we choose it. You can see it's chosen by the highlighted square around it.
Mm-hmm.
Say, okay, let's take a look at it. So, and then you can change the pen number, so when you go into to one
color.
Of the plotters,
yeah.
Yeah, it's different pens.
Oh, does it support the other HPGL plotters too,
yes.
Or just the two small ones?
No, it supports the other ones also. Yeah.
How transportable
is the data. Say you run a VisiCalc and you want to make a graph out of it. Did I understand that it's totally transportable? How do you
That's
do
correct.
That?
That's correct. It is. You can take that the data from a VisiCalc on the 150 and take it over to the 150 graphics and plot that.
You do that with a touch screen,
that's
basically?
Correct.
Yeah. Now why isn't that? Why do you need 1, 2, 3? I noticed that that's coming.
Yes.
Why do you need it if all of this is already transferable?
Well, because some people say, I'm familiar with using 1, 2, 3, and I want to, if your machine doesn't have it.
But this does its own version of 1, 2, 3.
That's
what,
right.
Yeah.
Exactly.
In fact, it's really 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Is that right? In other words, it's more than just three programs that you're
That's right.
compatible
That's right.
with. Yeah.
Is that the same thermal paper as the other HP?
Well, that's quite, isn't it?
Same type of thing.
You can also use the personal card file application if you wanted to do a mass mail into a specific customer list. You can do a mail merge as well.
Any plans to put something like concurrent to see what you want to
do?
No specific plans at this point in time. We're open to other operating systems, and I think it would really depend on the market demand, whether we would choose that or perhaps Xenix or Unix, which also could be honored to, but no plans at this point in time. We'll see what our customer base is really wants.
On pricing, I was a little bit surprised to find the difference in price between with and without the disks of only $800, $850, given that that disk pack sells for $1,775. I assume that is strictly for marketing reasons. One of the applications I have in mind is replacing a light pen device for menu work.
Well, the dual 3.5-inch floppy has been reduced to $1,250 list price.
Okay.
And yes, from marketing reason standpoint, we have bundled it in along with those other disks in a very attractive way. You'll note that all the combination of the CPU and each one of those three disk drives is a very good deal.
Yes.
To buy together.
$6,450 for 15 megabytes is.
We priced that very aggressively.
Is this a product that the instrumentation people expect to do things with, given that you've got an HPIB coming out, or are the efforts still going to be on the Series 200 for that?
We have several instrument divisions that are looking at using EHP 150 in their systems, not only in the instrument group, but in our analytical group and our medical group. They're looking at it right now. I would think that there's a very high probability you'll start to see the 150 appearing in a lot of different systems throughout the company.
I've done a lot of instrumentation work with everything from 85s and 9835s and 9816, and given the choice between that and an 85, the 85, I'll give it away.
Right.
But as long as there's some orientation towards that market.
Well, the 9816s and that family of products are really ideal for that, those kind of applications they were designed for. The thing that's particularly intriguing, I think, to all of those instrument people today is that the 150 is going to have the lion's share of all the industry standard software on it. It's got the touch capability, which is beautiful to use for instrument control.
The packaging, if you want a hard disk, there's no way you can get anywhere close to the pricing any other way.
Yeah, it's priced attractively to do that. The instrument people are at our division all the time, right? There. What comes out, I don't know. I think you might see in the open market as well, since we're going to support and document the hardware interface to build cards. I think that you have a good chance of seeing several outside supplied, not marketed by HP at all, just outside supplied A to D's, D to A's, general purpose duplex registered cards, etc.
How much room is there in there?
There's two slots right now, and each slot is 40 square inches.
Okay. So there's room for one big memory board and
something else.
Something else.
No matter what happens.
Plans for an expansion chassis?
Yeah, that's true.
We've looked at that. There's no specific plans right now. We might get around that some other ways.
Yeah.
see things coming out.
Depending on what the demand is. That's right. You get HBIB. All sorts of things you can do on that.
With, you know, 2 hours, 232 ports, and HPIB built in, you got a lot of capability.
Is the intention for external printer drive to be strictly HPIB, or is there a printer port?
Yeah.
Well, actually, you've got RS-232.
You got 2 hours, 232 ports today, and so you can drive our letter quality printers. In fact, are driven off of the RS-232. So.
Yeah, there's
going to
be a lot of blood on the floor
of the day. What is your letter quality printer? Is it all your own Mac, or is it something like
No, they're Diablo printers, and I'm not sure of the Diablo model numbers. I think it's a 620 and a 630 are the two that we've had modified.
I think I will.
We OEM
from
them.
2 to 3 years.
They're both Diablo drives.
So they're priced roughly like Diablo's too?
Unbelievable. Depends on where you would buy them. That's the process. I suspect that when you buy them from HP and get all the support that goes along with that, I think they wind up being a little higher priced. And it depends on how you choose to interface them. Whether I believe one of them can be supported either HPIB or RS-232. Depends on you.
The Epson is RS-232 or parallel or HPIB.
Yes.
So many of them. Okay. There's just going to be so much competition that nobody would put money at.
Well, that depends on how you decide to use your system. There are people that use other printers, and I guess you can attach other printers to the system. All the ones that we supply, we just ensure that they're all perfectly mated and supported in the software, which is makes life easy when you start to put the system together.
Do you have logo or any of those other children's things?
Not at this point in time. Logo is pretty interesting. Be one for us to look at this next year. I think, frankly, right now we got our plate full and getting out all the software packages that we have on that list. We have a large division there in our personal software division and will aggressively pursue more. But before we take on one, I'm going to get all those finished that we've got. We'll also be introducing a product in Europe starting in January. The base product, one thing I didn't mention, but it does speak 15 languages the way it sits over there right now. So we'll be announcing it and supporting it throughout Europe in 15 languages.
With 15 different character sets?
Well, it's only one character set. The one character set in the product supports all 15 major European languages. We have defined a character set in the corporation that we call Roman 8, which is uses the base 128, the standard ASCII, and the top 128 characters have all the unique characters to support the 15 major languages in Europe. So the base product speaks all of those with the extended character key that's on there, and between that and the shift capability, you can access them. So you can get umlauts and quesadillas or whatever they're called, cedillas, all those different characters. So we'll have 15 different keyboard layouts. We'll be producing our documentation in 5 major languages. And supplying those out of distribution centers throughout Europe with localized application software. So in several, let's say 5 or 6 locations in Europe, we now have software divisions, or really software operations, to modify the software and adapt, and they're all doing it right now. That's all in the process. Localized, complete, not all the packages, but where feasible, localized application software in the first part of next year. We think that's going to be a big contribution. We think we'll have the most localized product.
The story said that, and then the next day we get a correction.
As far as compatibility with the IBM PC, everyone kind of using that as a guide. You talk about compatibility to the programs, compatibility as far as the software is concerned, and where does your product stand as far as MS-DOS compatibility with PC?
The best example that I can give is it took MicroPro, I understand, about 2 hours to move the WordStar running on the IBM PC over and have it running on the HP 150. So as you move between PCs that run MS-DOS, today virtually everyone in the marketplace uses a different screen format. They have a different number of pixels. They have a different alpha system and how they support that. And you have to adapt, in most cases, your software to utilize that. We have these AGIOS commands built in. You can really make things happen fast by using those. Some people have used various escape sequence combinations and whatever, but I think if your software works in MS-DOS, then it should be a relatively simple matter to move it over and have it running on the HP.
What about the graphics capabilities? You find I noticed that you have greater graphics capability than the IBM. Yeah. Does that mean you would not be compatible with their graphics programs per se?
Well, it depends on how they've been written. If they address pixel by pixel, then we don't have that much compatibility. If in fact they use a lot of the some of the standards that are emerging, some of the things that I can't remember the name of the packages that DRI offers today, but the GKS kinds of standards to address the graphics plane, it becomes easier and easier. So it really depends on how the software's been written.
With the languages, there are no real standard commands for graphics. Everybody throws their own on. I can take BASIC on an Apple. There's one set of commands, BASIC on the IBM. You have another set of commands to work in graphics. You have another set. Okay.
I think there's some emerging standards there today. We don't see exactly what those standards are, and I think it's going to take some time for them to take place in the market.
Will your Pascal have Turtle graphics?
I can't answer that.
This one will be easier. Who is the contact for ISVs?
ISVs. I would call directly.
For example, I'd
write Tom Anderson at our personal software division. And they just moved, I can't give you their address. They are in Sunnyvale, California. I just want you to send it to my address, and it'll.
Okay.
But to the personal software division of Tom Anderson, it'll get routed over to him. Tom's the general manager of that division, responsible for all of our PC software, not only the ISV software, but all of our internally developed software. It's a fairly large entity. And their charter is to ensure that all that software that we develop runs on portables and general purpose desktops and technical desktops. We got one software entity, one way to get common software.
And then you take the number and
give it to one group.
So
we did.
Thank you, Bob.
Let's say we right now have MS-DOS on a 5.25-inch disk. How would we be able to convert it over to the smaller floppy that you're using? Is there some sort of a service?
You mean MS-DOS applications or files?
Let's say, I don't know, not WordStar, but something like that. Let's say we had it on an IBM PC now. Would it be possible to just transfer it over? Is there some service?
Got a link.
We have this link package that I talked about. A lot of people have been... Just the hackers today find it very easy to just connect the RS-232 ports together and start sending files back and forth.
So there's a communications package that you offer that you can connect through a modem or something?
The link package that we will offer to run in the IBM PC will really make it easy. You don't need a modem, and just connect the RS-232 ports together with a cable and send it back separately.
When you evaluated the various options for pointing, like the touch screen or the mouse or the roll, trackball and all those things, you must have come up with some various levels of priority, or which came in second after touch screen? I mean, did you rate them?
No. I think they come in for different types of applications, and they're very different, and I suspect that we'll wind up supporting many of them.
Nobody asked me about a mouse.
I think we'll probably have a mouse. We have tablets on many of our products today. I think the only way that you can draw effectively is with a tablet. If you'd like to use a cursor, you use a cursor. If you'd like to use touch, you can use touch. If you'd like to touch the soft keys on the screen, or if you'd like to touch them on the keyboard, all the software that's been written uses it either way. It just doesn't care. We've made it a really clear focus on making sure that all the software that runs using touch can run using the keyboard, at least almost all of it, I think.
Yeah. That's going to happen.
Also, the finger, yeah.
Sure.
The touch resolution, once again, I didn't get that before.
Two characters wide and one character high. So a cursor basically is one character.
Okay.
And so then the touch is two characters wide. That's two cursors wide.
Okay, and then as far as the resolution on the screen, what is that now?
Well, 27 by 40, that is the number of individual positions on the screen that we can resolve. And 27 by 40 turns out to be two wide and one high because there's 27 lines and 80 characters wide. We get 40 characters wide is what we can resolve.
Okay, what about the pixel resolution on the screen, X and Y?
In the graphics plane, it's 512 by 390. In the alpha plane, it's 720 by 360. And one of the reasons in the alpha plane that all those characters look so clear is we actually use a half dot shift capability. So what you're really seeing is 1440 by 360 in the alpha plane. Mm-hmm. And if you look at those characters, they're just perfect.
Great. Thank you.
Sure.
Okay.
Congratulations.
This is a card too. It's integrated with the graphic software, so that you can automatically pass the data. You can also include spreadsheets in a Word document as well.
Okay.
You have your two RS-232s, your HPIB, IEEE 488 standard for connecting peripherals.
This is there?
Yes, indeed. Mm-hmm. You can notice it's connected from the processor to the disk drive.
Mm-hmm.
You'd also be able to connect peripherals such as plotters and printers.
Okay.
Up to 15 different devices can be connected together using the same HPIB, which mm-hmm. is simply daisy chain them. You can connect up to mainframe computers and to other serial type devices using the RS-232 ports.
You have a program called, I think it's Link?
Yes, indeed.
And how would you make the connection between like an IBM PC to this to transfer programs to that terminal?
Once you set the terminal characteristics through the DSN Link program, it's simply telling it you're going through either port 1 or port 2 mm-hmm. and connect it up on a cable to the IBM.
Okay.
All right, ready?
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Yeah. And also, you hold your hand out like you're really drawing for 4 hours at a time. It's like holding a paintbrush. Yeah, you get tired. Whereas just setting your hand down is okay. So I think making selections is fine, where you just go up and you make a selection and you come
yeah.
back. But I don't think you'd want to draw really with a touch screen for that.
For selecting windows, though, would be very nice.
Oh, yeah.
2 points.
Yeah, and I think the bigger you want to make the buttons that you were trying to hit basically as big as possible, so you could just throw it good like that. But you wouldn't want to have to pick something fairly small. It just takes too much effort to aim.
Yeah.
Is that we have a special on a great number of our terminals today that we've provided for years to support video monitors. And that everything we've used in here is developed by the same
See, because when
we
I'm,
just haven't
the reason I'm asking is that there are every single computer comes out, there are problems with any time a large audience wants to see what's on the screen.
Yeah.
And they want to bring it out to a projector. And the projector wants to see regular video, just like we would run on videotape here. A lot of times they plug it into the projector and the projector has the picture coming out like this or rolls.
We have done it for years and years and years with our terminals and
and it's worked
we
okay.
have had, yes. oh yeah, no problem. Yeah, it's a standard special, I would say. Now, one of the strategies we have with this product is I've been kind of adding no options and no specials.
Oh, okay.
If we're going to be cost competitive, that's one of the things. That's one of the biggest requests that we've got, and we might need to make that available as a rework special. We get requests from training centers.
Yeah.
You guys are going to want them for classroom training. Dealers are going to want them.
Yep. One of our dealers asked us about that yesterday.
I don't want to put it in as a standard, but that might be a special that we have to make.
Yeah, I agree.
So.